Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following.
In 1973, a few people supported by the 20th Century Fund and one or two other concerned foundations formed something called the National News Council. Its purpose is to receive complaints against the press, more comprehensively against the media, and rule whether a particular complaint is substantive, i.e., whether the newspaper, magazine, or television program had trespassed over the line from opinion to distortion. Mr. William Rusher was a founding member of the National News Council and has just now completed his 7-year hitch as one of the arbiters. Although no one that I am aware has caused the National, has accused the National News Council of dereliction, its findings have not been widely publicized. And one thesis is that the reason for it is the progressive arrogance, or at least vanity, of the press, which in turn sometimes writes as though it were in fear for its life, given the recent rulings of the Supreme Court. To discuss these questions, we have Mr. Rusher, a graduate of Princeton, of the Harvard Law School, a practicing lawyer who, after a half dozen years, went to Washington to serve on the staff of a congressional investigating committee, and then came to New York to serve as publisher of National Review. That was in 1956. In addition to his duties as publisher, he writes books and syndicates a column. His forthcoming volume will be published in July. It is called How to Win an Argument. Mr. Michael Kramer is the national political writer for New York Magazine. He is familiar to viewers of this program. He was formerly publisher and editor-in-chief of More Magazine, a graduate of Amherst in 1967, who went on to the Columbia Law School, from which he graduated 10 years ago. He is the co-author of two books, The Ethnic Factor and I Never Wanted to Be Vice President of Anything, a biography of Nelson Rockefeller. I'd like to begin by asking Mr. Rusher if he would give us an idea of how a specimen complaint gets handled by the National News Council.
Well, to take a concrete example, a man named William Gavin in Washington complained to the council against the New York Times. His protest was that whenever the New York Times, and he cited specific examples, reported on an abortion controversy anywhere, it always took care to mention the religion of the anti-abortionist, if it was a Roman Catholic, but that they never performed a similar service if the person in favor of letting the woman have the abortion or passing the law to that effect was a Protestant or a Jew or somebody who just plain didn't happen to be a Roman Catholic. He thought that there was a constant reiteration of this theme that you had to be a Roman Catholic to oppose abortion. He didn't think it was true. Of course, it's not.
Did he have, according to the rules of the National News Council, do you have to have standing in order to make
this? That's precisely why I chose this particular illustration. He wasn't libeled personally. He is, I guess, a Roman Catholic himself, but he was just somebody who was offended by what he thought was an improper journalistic practice. So he wrote, as you have to under our rules, or we wrote on his behalf when he made the complaint, to the New York Times and said, "What do you say in reply?" Well, the New York Times, under its present management, has a firm rule. It won't even answer mail from the National News Council. It doesn't even say, "Dear Sir, drop dead." It just plain.
How come he was writing under the stationery of the National News Council? I thought he was writing as an individual.
He was, but I said he either writes himself first to complain to the paper, or if he hasn't done that, when his complaint was received, I don't know which was the case in this particular situation, we will write on his behalf and say, "We have received this complaint from Mr. William Gavin, thus and so. Do you have any reply?" And the New York Times, unlike most of the major networks now, unlike, I think, at this point, the Washington Post and many other papers around the country, the New York Times simply, in its sovereign capacity, flatly refuses to give any answer at all, even goodbye. to anybody's question of that type. So we then proceeded to hear and adjudicate the matter anyway, and it was decided, I think I earmarked this among other cases, a fairly short comment of the council.
First of all, who constitutes the council?
The council,
how many people?
18 people who are divided between media members, members who are actually work in the media, and public members who are specifically prohibited from being employees of media.
Is it suggested that there's any political bias among the membership? Or do they have to be half Republicans? Have
No, nothing like that. There's no such rule. And I must say, on the basis of my tenure on it, I was deep in the minority as a conservative, but where were we not among things of that sort in those days?
Except among the people.
Except, as it turned out, among the people, and at National Review and a couple of other enlightened joints around town. But the I must say, I saw very little evidence of political bias. The people there, the liberals too, did their level best to keep that out of it. I mean, in most cases, at any
rate. So, in other words, what you're about to read is not something that came out from a right-wing
No, not at all, and it was unanimous among those who participated in the decision. The council said, in the present complaint, 8 persons were identified by name and by political or organizational affiliation. An example was Mrs. Hilda Kilgore, described as executive director of the Planned Parenthood Center of Nashville. Her religion was not mentioned, nor were the religions of any of the other persons who either were political office holders or office seekers. Referring to the race for a U.S. Senate seat in Iowa, the Times story said, and they quote the Times story, at the center of the anti-abortion campaign is a state political action committee, Pro-Life Action Council, headed by Carolyn Thompson, a Roman Catholic and a registered nurse, who has long been active in the National Right to Life Committee. Then the council went on and concluded, in keeping with its, and this is, I might say that Gavin had made this same complaint twice before, and on the second occasion it had been found warranted. At that time. So this was a third. It says, in keeping with its previously stated recommendation about reporting religious affiliation, the council believes that the identification of Ms. Thompson as Roman Catholic was unfair in the context of the entire story, since no other individual was identified by religion. In the light of repeated complaints on this specific issue, the council can only conclude that the Times is either insensitive to justifiable criticism or is condoning careless editing. The complaint is found warranted. And that was unanimously held by I guess about 10 members of the council who happened to be present at that meeting, and left, right, and center politically.
Now, what kind of a play did that finding get in the nation's press?
I don't know about
What happens when finding is made? Is it?
I can tell you what happens in an average case of any importance at all, and I think that would be in this category. The wire services will carry at least a short story on it, so that papers around the country who want it will have it that way, and television stations, radio stations. Sometimes the New York Times itself has reported, not in most cases criticisms of itself, but it has gotten around to the point where it used to keep us back in the shipping lanes section. I remember it was even beyond the obituaries. They have a small agate type that is used for those who are the walking dead. And we had things reported in that stuff for a while, but I have seen in the New York Times not long ago a decision we made, a ruling that a complaint by Shell Oil against NBC's Evening News was held warranted, and that got about a 2-column head on an inside page in the Times.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Kramer, is it your judgment that something like the National News Council is a desirable institutionally? You, after all, ran a paper that focused almost exclusively on the crotchets and difficulties and the whole nature of the problems of the press. Did you ever arrive at an editorial position on it?
I've always been in favor of the council. I've always wondered not about the impartiality of its members, but rather who appointed it. And what standing does it have, rather than someone who complains to it? I think, by the way, that's the reason that the Times refuses to.
What's the reason?
That the Times refuses to
That it was born parthogenetically.
Yes.
Who appointed the founding fathers?
Well, that's, you know, of course you can make these, you know, make these arguments.
Who appointed the time?
I'm not here you know, to defend them. I think one of the reasons, by the way, that you're getting even scant mention in the Times these days, and larger mention in the professional journals, to the extent that something like the Columbia Journalism Review
is
a professional journal.
I should mention that. Mike reminded me, the Columbia Journalism
Which
Review
incorporated more.
Carries right. every decision of the council in a special section toward the back of the magazine on specially colored paper.
I think a more interesting question is, after your decision, have there been any other articles that the Times has run where they've either continued this practice or
You mean where they were the defendants?
No,
where in an abortion story,
have they
for example.
Kept on mentioning Roman Catholics. I'd say this, as of December 31st, when I stepped down, no further complaint of that type had been brought.
You see, typically in the case of an institution like the Times or some other organizations that feel that they are the sole repositories of wisdom and truth, they will quietly go along.
Yeah.
And therefore acknowledge the veracity of the complaint and but never the legitimacy of the institution that, mm-hmm. that rendered such a decision. Mm-hmm. I think the council is useful and serves a decent purpose because quite obviously the press is an institution almost without exception that that can only police itself and is by virtue of the First Amendment and the politics of this country has free rein. Mm-hmm.
There is, by the way, a very good precedent of sorts in the British Press Council, which has been going just over 25 years now. It deals only with the press, as it happens, not with the electronic media. Excuse me. But it is now supported financially by the press in Britain and grudgingly accepted as a good thing. The individual papers don't always like its criticisms. But after a long period in which they were disliked and contemned every bit as much as the National News Council, they have gradually established themselves. I think the council is doing that too.
I think the reason that there was grudging acceptance in Britain and probably an increasing acceptance in the United States is frankly that so what? Mm-hmm. These decisions are rendered and nothing much matters and changes.
Well, there is so this. Is I really think that the influence of the council is always, or the British Press Council for that matter, is always going to be hard to measure because it isn't what people do as a result of its being there, but what they don't do. And how do you, it's like Mahan's fleet in being. As long as you have it, you don't need to use it. And that is the real virtue of a council like ours. I know in my bones, if nowhere else, that in newsrooms, let's take just the writing of the news stories on the evening news and television, and the big three networks, that there have been again and again times they said, well, we better not to say that or do this particular thing, or we're sure as the Dickens going to get condemned again by the National News Council for being unfair. Mm-hmm. And yet it's very hard to prove that.
Okay, let's discuss the graduation of sanctions. We start with a voluntary organization which has no authority whatsoever. It issues its dispensations more or less in vacuo, and people can run them or need not. And there's no sanction there. Mr. Rusher mentioned the institution in Great Britain in South Africa. You may or may not join their national press association, whatever it is, i.e. you have the option of not doing so. If you do, certain privileges inure to you. I can't enumerate them, but apparently there are some. But also certain responsibilities. Among the responsibilities are that you are required to devote the same space, and roughly speaking, the same position as you devoted in a story against which the defendant complains. And if indeed he wins a sympathetic judgment from the National News Council, which is mostly composed of, I think, retired judges, then the offending paper has to reproduce, in effect, an apology or the correct version or whatever. Does that appeal to you?
Partially. I don't think that these questions can be considered outside of the context of the society in which these institutions crop up. My particular quarrel with South Africa, which may not be other persons, involves issue of apartheid, and I don't know enough about it to discuss it here. I would only say that in the United States, where this kind of sanction is not available to those who feel aggrieved by the press, I wonder really how damaged people and causes are these days. The polls tell us, and we'll sit here and you'll sit here and quote the polls sometimes too about other subjects, that the press is held in very low regard, as low as, or lower than many politicians and other institutions. We also know that readership of newspapers has declined and people are picking up more of their information from television, from magazines like People. So where is the proof that we need to, or what is the rationale for an overlay, a mechanism, an institution to correct things that the press may or may not do wrong, when it seems to me that we've gotten along fairly well for 200 years without it, and with the presumption being on the other side, and the presumption admittedly is one where the press is right to print whatever it chooses.
I should think in the United States, the very clear reason for the very clear proximate justification for such an arrangement is the ruling in the Supreme Court in New York Times versus Sullivan, in which, of course, the burden shifted from the newspaper to prove that what it said was correct. Mm-hmm. To the victim, assuming that he was a public figure, to prove that the motivation of the editor or the writer was actual malice, as they call it under the law. That's right. They proceeded in reckless disregard of the known fact. Now, given the inaccessibility of the court to rescue a victim's honor, or even his pocketbook, if in fact he was affected economically, some other device, it seems to me, is appropriate. Now, none such exists in the United States, which may be one reason why the courts are backing off a little bit from their exclusive concern for the rights of the author and the publisher, as witness a couple of recent decisions that have said in effect so-and-so is not a public figure, and a decision much criticized in which the motives...
Yes. Mental operation.
What's that?
The mental operation.
That's right. The motives of the editor were subject to pretrial examination.
The press hated that, but the truth was that once the court had held that you had to prove actual malice, there was no way in logic that you could prevent a plaintiff's attorney from inquiring into mental operations.
Well, logic doesn't get in the way of the Supreme Court. In the first place, it was a very close decision.
Nonetheless, that's true. Sometimes the Supreme Court flies in the face of logic, but nonetheless, I think that the one, and it's generally been conceded among the media that the one did finally follow from the other. If they were going to be using the malice rule, they had to tell about the
way. I don't know how generally conceded it was, but I
find among some surprising people in the New York area that I talked to.
Well, and I think, frankly, that anyone, again, there was a context. Journalists become journalists by declaring themselves such, and by having gentlemen such as yourselves hire people like me to write for you. We have no special qualifications. And yet, once we are, once we become journalists and are able to publish that which we choose to publish, these rights come over us, and we have them to exercise.
Well, I think you're absolutely right in saying that one of the problems with the journalistic community is defining it as a category. And this has been one of the reasons Berger mentioned it in Bellotti as to why it is not desirable to define them as a class having special rights. And the court has by narrow margins so far, stayed away from conferring on the media all the rights, privileges, and immunities that they began demanding vociferously during the 1970s.
Well, let's get to that in just a minute, because I'm anxious to solicit both of your opinions on on the question of whether, in fact, the Supreme Court has declared war on the press, which is the way it was made sound a couple of years ago. But let's just finish transacting this matter of libel. It seems to me that we have come dangerously close to a public situation in which the disregard for the truth is really the prevailing ethic. If the truth doesn't matter, it means that you're living in a society that is insensitive to the correctness of a particular charge. Now, the mechanisms of a libel suit, and I'm talking to two lawyers here, the mechanism of a libel suit is so cumbersome, so expensive, that de facto a lawsuit is excluded unless the victim is a member of an institution that can afford it or is himself personally wealthy. I think it a culturally interesting point that simultaneously you have a lot of people who say, well, if Eisenhower in fact is not a member of the Communist Party, why didn't he sue the John Birch Society? And at the same time you have a great many people who say, what does it matter if he was a member of the Ku Klux Klan? Now, I happen to think that this is deplorable, that the notion that anybody can say anything about anybody without facing the consequences of a tort action is wrong, and I have my own private solution for the problem. But is it your position, Mr. Kramer, that Sullivan versus New York Times was an unalloyed social blessing?
Well, I wouldn't go that far, but yes, I think it was. I think it was significant and a necessary decision, in to the extent that it defined the parameters of the First Amendment and freedom of the press. I think that whenever someone feels so aggrieved, and I'm leaving aside the very real question you pose about cost and the mechanism, the cumbersome aspects of the mechanism of libel suits. But whenever someone feels so aggrieved that their reputation is so tarnished, they can sue. Carol Burnett is now suing the National Enquirer. Query whether her reputation was really sullied by that. Does it really matter, for example, that they said those things about her? How is she harmed? I think it was awful that they did that. It seems clear to me from just following the case in the press that it was an example of something that should not be permitted, and she should probably, in my view, win this case. But her suit is a negligence suit as much as you know, other litigious action can be from when someone poor is aggrieved by a landlord or something like that. I don't see where society in general has been harmed by permitting the press this protection, although surely the chance is there for the press to abuse its privilege. And again, I keep going back to a context. We've sat here over many years talking about the liberal bias of the press. You've written about it. You've written about it. And yet we have Ronald Reagan as president. Something went right from your point of view. Somehow the liberal press was not able to stop this travesty. So the system is working, it seems to me, and I don't think we need any public or private mechanisms to chain or shackle the press. I think, in a word, Times versus Sullivan was a good case.
Well, I think that to say that Ronald Reagan is president and therefore the press can't stand in the way of the Kuwait imperative is a very little consolation to incidental victims along the line. Carol Burnett makes $1 million a day or whatever the hell she makes, so she can afford to take action against the National Enquirer, and on the assumption that she has a good case, I hope she socks it to them the way somebody did to Confidential. Mm-hmm. 20, 25 years ago, and cut out that fever swamp, drain that fever swamp. However, it seems to me that the retreats during the past 15 years from the unalloyed view of the New York Times versus Sullivan are a reflection of a certain social dissatisfaction with felt injustice. Now, as I say, my clear solution, since you haven't asked me for, which I thought was very rude of you, is very simply this, that the loser would have to pay the court costs of the winner. Because it's all very well to win $5,000 having spent $190. We were sued by Linus Pauling for saying the exact truth about him, and we won. He was tossed out of court, and our bill was $190,000. Now, that was very heroic of us, I thought, but it was also extremely costly. Mm-hmm. Whereas in Great Britain, he would have been charged $190,000 plus Z, the $300 that he gave us for court costs.
Perhaps you should have access to the same kind of legal aid, a mechanism that the president is now ending.
Well, I think our institution could prove indigence. As a matter of fact, I can't think of any libel suits that were actually backed by the Legal Aid Society over there, but by the legal.
I would bet there are. You've got out there under the legal assistance program 6,000 hot-eyed young liberal lawyers looking for nominal plaintiffs to whip up in class action suits. And if they didn't think of libel somewhere along the line, they're even more incompetent than I think they are.
None of them happen to occur to me. Well, all right. Let's agree that the libel laws as they currently stand reflect a disquieting indifference to the whole epistemology of a free society. I mean, is he or is he not what he was said to be by the National Enquirer, the New Republic, or National Review? And the mechanism for an adjudication of that is there are people, I think of Nat Hedhoff, who labor under the romantic delusion that men who are public figures have adequate access to retaliatory channels, that if somebody says, you're a Nazi, after all, my God, you're an extremely important editor of New York City, you can say, no, I'm not, or he's a communist, or whatever. I don't think this is a satisfactory way to settle this. But of course, we're talking about an extremist in the sense that Nat Hedhoff wants to abolish all libel legislation, yeah, as did the reigning nabobs of the American Civil Liberties Union.
Well, the reality of that situation, for example, taking your hypothetical, would be something like this. X newspaper, not in a monopoly situation, since they do not exist in the United States in the sense that in any market, even if there is only one paper, there are TV stations, radio stations, there is other media available. If someone is labeled a Nazi who's not a Nazi, you can be damn well sure that some other media is going to love to pounce on that charge and sock it to the media that made the mistake. It's not as if there was no means for redress. There are.
There are means for redress, but the question is there a motivation for redress? A number of things were said about Barry Goldwater when he ran president of the United States.
And he sued.
That's correct.
He sued
in one very discreet case where this pornographer turned psychological expert decided that he could prove that Goldwater was certifiably nuts. He got an award of $85,000 and a legal bill for $85,000, which, by the way, was a sweetheart bill by a guy who subsequently went to the federal court. But the things that were probably most generally damaging about him were not actually the kind of thing that he could sue against. He wanted to kill little girls in the atomic holocaust.
Well, who'd believe that?
Well, the most expensive media expert in New York City was paid a lot of money
to create that commercial that ran once.
Which presumably are added to the obscene plurality of Lyndon Johnson.
Well, but again, even the people who hired Tony Schwartz to make that commercial saw that it was backfiring or had the potential to backfire and pulled it after it was shown once.
Yeah, only for utilitarian reasons. not because they were afraid of a lawsuit or for ethical reasons.
No, but that's true. But that's a realm. Political comment is not what you're talking about. I mean, the people like yourself who've run for office on occasion, are willing to give up certain privacy to allow yourself to be bombarded by we bad fellows in the media because you're trying to elect yourselves to something. And I guess you would probably disagree with that, but this is part of the game,
no.
And people understand that.
It's interesting you say that because the buzzword is the chilling effect. We have New York Times versus Sullivan because we don't want a chilling effect for you writing about me.
That's right.
But not many people talk about the chilling effect of me. I made a proposal which was considered 10 years later absolutely anemic for lack of vigor and was accused by John Lindsay and God knows how many people of wanting to set up concentration camps for people who disagreed with me. Now, it is incorrect to say that I run for public office from time to time. I ran once. And I don't doubt that one of the reasons why I ran once, the most emphatic one being that I was such a miserable candidate, was because I roiled under the kind of misinterpretation of what I said, which is temperamentally and psychologically frustrating.
Of course, if I may say a word here for the real little guy, Bill, you are not the best example yourself, precisely for an interesting reason. When somebody attacks you, as Lord knows they do from time to time, you are not utterly resourceless. The idea of you cowering in a corner while somebody calls you a Nazi.
No. I wrote a best-selling book about this.
Not only a best-selling book, you have a column in 200-plus newspapers, you have a television program. The guy who calls you a Nazi may live to regret having called you a Nazi. But what about the average person? Even the average public figure who doesn't have all those resources, even Carol Burnett, for instance, who doesn't have a column.
Yeah. What about the chilling effect, in other words, of the candidate who is exposed to all kinds of Billingsgate, well, worse than Billingsgate, when he runs? Occasionally that is mentioned by dissenters in these libels.
And may I, before we get away from this subject, mention one other category of concern, which has to do with people recently dead, but who were public figures. It seems now that we are seeing docudramas and factoids and pseudo-novels and one thing and another about people absolutely without any restraint at all, approximating the facts in this particular situation.
That's on my agenda.
Okay.
It
worries the daylights out of me.
I think this is the logical place to bring it out. In reviewing John Ehrlichman's first novel, for instance, I don't know whether you've read it, but there's a guy who's clearly Nixon, the guy who's clearly Kissinger, and the guy who's clearly so-and-so. He deals with them as sadistically as it is possible to do. You conclude that Nixon's crazy, put it this way, you conclude things about him that even you probably haven't decided he's guilty of. But there is no form of redress that I know of. Criminal libel is out. The notion a duel is out, and there is no operative social sanction that says, look, I don't want to associate with a guy who hides under this under the skirts of the First Amendment in order to effect that kind of Boskian character.
Now just to present the only difficulty I found with that analysis, what about Shakespeare's Richard III? This king has been
Dunciad,
beaten up for X hundred years because Shakespeare was in a Tudor court and disliking the Plantagenets. And we think the art justifies everything. We think Richard's reputation doesn't count, but I expect Richard thought it counted, or would have, had he known what people were going to be saying about him in 500 years. This was a docudrama in the same rather offensive way.
Well, at least you're talking there about dead people.
Now, we're talking, in many cases, about the recently dead here. There is nothing I know of to prevent some sensationalist novelist from writing an entire novel, all replete with characters recently living, around the central theme that Winston Churchill was gay, let's say. What could you do with that, you know? Not a word of truth in it, maybe, but nonetheless, it would give a certain lift to the novel.
His, for historical reasons, one resents this, but let's remember that under American law, you a dead man cannot sue for punitive damages. His estate can sue for actual damages, and it would be very hard to show that actual damages were visited on That's Churchill right. for that kind of offense. I think one has to present it for philosophical reasons. Simone Weil wrote in protest against Etienne Gilson's History of Greece, mm-hmm. that his failure to mention the plight of the Helots was such a historical travesty that in the ideal society he ought to go to jail. Well, this is an extreme view of things, but there was a kind of a fragility and health, a kind of a hygienic relationship between Simone Weil's thirst for the truth that the attenuation of two mm-hmm. millennia was unaffected by it. Now, if however, you say, all right, you can do what you want to Richard III, but you can't do what you want to Richard Nixon, who's alive and living 20 blocks from where we're sitting, I think that you face a more direct question, don't you?
Absolutely. And
legally, you face a very different question. That's,
that's right, but legally, he would have no leg to stand on. Richard Nixon could not sue John Ehrlichman for
because
that Ramona
Because of public figure business? Well, now, wait a minute. Whoa, flag on that play. Just a second. He could if he could establish that there was actual malice.
He could if he could establish that...
Well, what's so improbable about that, if we went down to it, this stage of the game between Ehrlichman and Nixon?
Well, no, well, you've got the protection that he wasn't called Nixon, he was called somebody else.
Yeah, but I don't think that's...
There is the woman who wrote a novel in which one of the characters was somebody who did or didn't practice nudism, I forget which.
Yeah, there right.
was
a woman
she said
who,
the wrong thing.
There was a
she
woman who just collected against Playboy, or was it Penthouse, I don't want to get the magazine wrong, for the same thing. She was proved to a jury that she, in fact, was the woman that this fictional article was referring to, that she was the Miss Wyoming
was
or whatever
Penthouse,
it was.
Yeah.
Miss Wyoming.
So there is redress. In the case of a supposedly fiction, something labeled fiction, you just don't get away with it by labeling something fiction. Richard Nixon probably, you know, might be able to make the case that in fact he was the president.
Of course, what you get
John
into is that whole series
spoken,
of,
fall
of
back
considerations.
On
do you really want to publicize it that much more?
That's right. You really get into a situation in which, as a practical matter, given the federal rules of procedure, mm-hmm. you can't devote the rest of your life to the pretrial discovery that would precede that kind of a trial.
You may remember what Paul Krasner's, what was it, the realists have said about Lyndon Johnson. You couldn't even put it on the air here.
Well, he was probably judgment-proof.
well, maybe, but the printers, he had to go to three different printers before he found one that would take it, as I recall.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. But Johnson, although it was the scandal of Washington, would have been very foolish to sue, even though I think he could have recovered under Sullivan or anything else, because he would simply have publicized the charges.
Yeah, oh well, or take some, of course, that was so preposterous that it would have been almost embarrassing even to state the complaint.
Exactly.
But there was a thing called Mack Bird, which was a big Broadway, mm-hmm. off-Broadway play, which alleged that Johnson contrived the assassination of Kennedy. And it may be that you reach such a level of eminence that you simply can't permit yourself to notice these things. But those of us who haven't achieved that level of eminence
still notice.
Can still miss it. Right. All right. Well, in just a second or two, I want to introduce the examiner, Professor Vandenhaag. But let's at least cite, because it is part of the agenda, the decisions of the Supreme Court, which caused a number of editors to take the position that there was dwindling liberty, dwindling protections by the First Amendment of the press. The first was Brandberg versus Hayes in 1972, in which reporters were told that they would have to answer questions that pertained to a criminal investigation. Then there was Zirkfer versus the Stanford Daily, in which the court ruled that the officials in California had a right with a warrant to make a surprise raid on the premises of the Stanford newspaper. By the way, a rule that has been
overridden, if I understand it,
by the
Carter legislation of 1980. Then there was the Myron Farber case, in which in a murder trial, Dr. Jaskolowicz, Myron Farber actually spent time in jail because he refused to turn over to the judge the notes that he had taken, which in fact led to his indictment for murder. Then there was the Gannett versus DePasquale case, in which the Supreme Court ruled that the Sixth Amendment guaranteed a public trial for the convenience of the defendant. And if the defendant wanted to waive that trial, that was completely up to him, modified in a subsequent decision, the Richmond versus Virginia, to say, no, we didn't mean it. We met only in pretrial testimony. Now, let me ask you, Mr. Kramer, is there here, in your judgment, a insensitivity by the court to the requirements of a free press?
I personally don't think so. I think that in all actions or in anything that we write, we should be prepared to take consequences. If I'm a journalist and I consistently get my facts wrong, I deserve to be fired by the person who employs me. If the courts and the law decide that up against the rights and privileges that attend someone who's operating under the First Amendment, you still have to turn over your notes or face a jail term, then either I turn over my notes or I face the consequences and face a jail term. I think the balance is fairly decent here. I don't have any particular problem with it, although I know that if Mike Farber were here, he certainly would.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Bill?
Well, I think we have the press has the situation exactly reversed, 180 degrees. The press starts out, the media, with the assumption, which is gratuitous, that they have these privileges and immunities. Then they claim them. The matter gets appealed to the Supreme Court of the United States, which rules that they don't, whereupon the press feels it has been bereft of its privileges and immunities. And that's the way it looks to everybody. We get these editorials. Now, what's actually happened, you mentioned this matter of confidential sources. The first time it ever occurred to a reporter to claim the First Amendment as protection for a confidential source was way back in 1957 when Marie Torrey, who still has a television program here in town, was a CBS radio correspondent and pleaded it.
And went to jail.
And went to jail, affirmed by the United States Court of Appeals of the Second Circuit, on which was sitting Justice Potter Stewart, who hadn't yet matured his opinion of the First Amendment. It can't have been, because the Second Circuit affirmed the jailing. It had to be a federal case on diversity.
It could have bounced to the federal courts on appeal.
I'm not aware of an appeal.
The reason I say, because I was going to ask you whether there was a shield law.
No, there was no shield law. Shield laws are something politicians thought of in the 1970s after the reporters claimed these privileges, didn't get them from the Supreme Court, and then, of course, the politicians, irresponsible as usual, dashed in 26 states to confer protection on the reporters and get the credit for doing it, meanwhile knowing that, of course, the courts would always be there in case injustice was done to a defendant, and as the court was indeed there in the Jaskolowicz case in New Jersey and declared the Shield Law of New Jersey unconstitutional to the extent that it prevented...
Subordinate to the Sixth Amendment.
Well, just plain, yes, unconstitutional because it violated it in that particular application. So the press here, what's really going on is a bid for power on the part of the media. And it has been, by a vote of 5-4, in case after case, unsuccessful so far, and I'm kind of hoping that they will think after last November that maybe this isn't the time.
I have
to
no
bid
fear
for
that
power.
That majority will increase.
Why don't Brennan and Marshall resign?
I don't think you have to worry about that. Huh? It'll be 7-3 before you turn around.
Professor Ernest Vandenhaag is well known to viewers of this program. He is a practicing psychoanalyst and a professor of law at the New York Law School and the author of numerous books, Mr. Vandenhaag.
I have one question, or one and a half questions, for Mr. Kramer. He has indicated that he feels that the Sullivan decision, which made it very hard for a public personality to sue the press for libel, is useful. He supports it. My question is, did he detect that before that decision was rendered, the press was less free than it became afterwards? And a similar question.
In an objectionable way, less free, or do you mean just plain less free, period?
I'd like Mr. Kramer to
Because obviously it was less free.
Yes, it was less free.
It could print fewer libels.
All right, whether he objects to that lack of freedom or lack of possibility of abuse of freedom. Either way, let me just add one question which is quite similar. As you know, in Great Britain, there are much stronger libel laws than we have, and the press, therefore, is much more restrained. Do you feel, Mr. Kramer, that the British press is not sufficiently free for public purposes, that it lacks the freedom that you think is essential to a sound democracy because of these libel laws?
I think we're better off, to take your second question first, in the United States than we are in Great Britain, and we as a society generally, who are not under Thatcherism and that creeping kind of economics that I guess is about to be foisted on us. But
we don't want your opinion of Mrs. Thatcher. Answer the question.
Sure. Mm-hmm. I think that the press is less free in Great Britain.
Less free to do familiar. What? Well, it's certainly less free to print libel.
I meant less
free
to print
what
public
you
purposes.
Consider to be libel. No. Yes, less
Mr.
free
Kramer.
To attack public figures.
Let me suggest what I meant, not what you were to answer, of course. It is obvious that by definition it is less free, being more restricted by libel laws, but I'm asking you whether you think it is less free in the sense that it impairs the democratic freedoms that we both equally cherish, but that less freedom actually somehow interferes with the public function that the press ought to have.
I'm sure that it does, although I'm at a loss to give you specific
You cannot
examples.
Give me any instances.
No, because I'm not working under those restrictions. Mm-hmm. In answer to your first question, I would say that it is, although I was not reporting pre-Times versus Sullivan, I think that my general feeling about public figures and the whole question that case addressed is that seeking public office and becoming at least that part of being a public figure is something that you don't have to do. There is no constitutional protection for that kind of occupation.
You don't have to test Jim Crow either.
Well, that's true. I think, again, I go back to what I consider to be the bottom line, and that is that the politics of this country are working very well. We're having a complete turnaround changeover right now, despite what was perceived to be, a liberal bias.
Now, wait a minute. It could have been a liberal bias that was overridden.
That's true. Mm. But if we had
you
all this power...
You can't say that the election of Reagan proved that there wasn't a liberal bias.
No. But if we had all this power, Bill, right?
Now, wait a minute.
We're
not talking about power. We're talking about bias. At Princeton University, the faculty in 1972 went 67% for McGovern, 8% for Dick Gregory, and 6% for Nixon. Now, that certainly shows that Nixon didn't have the same kind of a break in this rather formidable engine of public opinion that he did in the hearts and minds of the people, right?
But yes, that's right. That's my point. If it is a question of power, if the press were considered not to be powerful, we wouldn't be speaking about
it
on this show.
My friend, the press is considered
that's
powerful and for
upset.
Certain purposes is powerful. You cannot use the fact that Reagan got elected either to prove that the press was not biased or that the press in certain times and for certain purposes isn't powerful. It can have, to use a military analogy, air control of the beachhead, without necessarily having much else. I think of Proposition, what was it in the California Valley way back in 1974, which was sort of the precursor of Proposition 13.
Proposition 1.
Special interests in California managed to defeat that one by scaring everybody to death. It was a rather complicated amendment, as I recall, a proposition. And in that sense, had plenty of power, and yet I think the people were, and turned out ultimately to be, of another mind. Press has power. The press, in my opinion, has in some cases too much power, but thank heavens, as demonstrated in November, doesn't have supreme power.
Mr. Kim, I must have overheard, but I really wanted to know whether you felt that the freedom of the press before Sullivan was so New York Times, was insufficient and now is insufficient. I haven't quite heard an answer.
I don't know, Mr. Kramer, because I didn't operate under those restrictions. Maybe Mr. Buckley, who was writing then,
I wonder why you are supporting that decision which enlarged the freedom of the press, unless you felt that previous to that decision, the freedom of the press was insufficient. But at any rate, let me ask Mr. Rusher, for variety, a different question. Quite recently, Mr. Rusher, several investigators pretended to be cameramen for one of the New York news channels to film people who were engaged in certain activities of interest to the investigative and agency. When that came out, the investigative agency made no end of apologies to the channel involved, admitting and implying that it is absolutely wrong for anyone investigating anything to pretend to be a journalist or an agent for the media and so on. My question is, do you think these apologies were justified? Do you think nobody working, say, as a spy or investigator ever should disguise himself as a journalist?
Well, there are several questions tangled up in that. Was this agency that masqueraded as journalists a government agency?
Yes.
Or a private detective would be something else again, right?
A government agency.
It was a government agency, and let's say FBI or whatever just pretended to be.
This CIA guy walked in and said, "My name is Abe Rosenthal. Can I take some pictures of you?"
That's the idea. That's roughly what happened, and. I would say this, in general, I don't approve of masquerades, but we have had that question come up in one form or another, not that particular form, for the National News Council, and in which reporters masquerade as doctors or hide like 60 minutes behind the screen and photograph people. You know, there's duplicity all over the world. Even the press has been known. And we, as I recall, in the council, took a rather dim view of that kind of duplicity, and I would of this. Now, if you get into a foreign situation, what I'm trying to protect is the concept that there might be a time, appropriately, when a journalist might act for the CIA or even use a journalistic cover for a CIA employment. That is a different question, and I'm rather more sympathetic to that than the council members have been in general.
Mm-hmm. You have time for one more question?
Mm-hmm.
In that case, Mr. Kramer, I haven't fully if I understood you, you rejected the National News Council, saying we have done for a long time without, so why introduce it?
I
misunderstand you?
No, I said I welcome the National News Council. Uh-huh. I think I raised two questions. One is I think it's important to know that they are self-appointed to the extent that they are. And secondly, to point out that in reality, they don't have much influence to change things. I'm sure that if they were somehow given the sanctions and authority that they don't have or that a comparable organization in South Africa has, that I would be sitting here saying that it was the worst thing ever to come down the pipe.
And I might add,
in other words,
the council
they're fine because they're harmless.
Mm-hmm. The members of the council would agree with you.
Well, I think so, but that is what we have against self-appointing. Whom would you want, who would you want to appoint the members of the council unless they have a co-option process? But I wonder, since we are, and this question is addressed to Mr. Rusher, who is a protagonist of the council, isn't one weakness that the council will address its objections largely to people, media, etc., who are in principle willing to follow the rules, responsive, therefore, to the council's objections?
Will criticize mostly those who cooperate with it.
Right. It will not be able to effectively criticize those who don't give a damn.
No, as witness the fact that they not only, in the case I cited, criticized the New York Times, but in a second go-round, criticized it again and accused it of being either insensitive or sloppy. I don't think they have held back. It sometimes is a little bit painful, I must admit, the other way around, to criticize roundly somebody who has provided you with a transcript, given you the tape of the show that is being condemned and so on. But nonetheless, the intelligent and statesmanlike
journalistic enterprises in this country understand that in the long run, I think they have more to gain than to lose from a National News Council, even if on the way to the long run, they themselves get criticized.
If only because they, it's an easy way to say that you're policing yourself.
It's a lot easier than being policed, I'll tell you that.
So. Effectively policed.
How about one more question addressed to Mr. Buckley? What is your opinion about a reporter having a right or not having the right to refuse to testify about his news sources, to offer in evidence his notes and so on, in effect the Myron Farber case? What I'm interested in, do you feel Mr. Farber was morally right in saying, I rather go to jail than offer what the court asked me to give? Or do you think that the court did have a right and that journalists do not have a privilege to withhold evidence that nobody else can withhold?
I think that the reporter who pot valiantly says to the person from whom he's getting information, under no circumstances whatsoever will what you tell me become public property or be divulged to anybody else, should feel that he could say so without making a subjective determination to suffer the death of a martyr, if need be, in order to guard that trust. It is commonly accepted among the priesthood that there does not exist a machine that will extract from the confessor, that will extract from the priest, the substance of a confession. Now, I have a feeling that certain of my colleagues in the press are given to rather insouciantly making this promise on the assumption that the establishment will somehow permit them to escape the consequences of a judicial determination that finds that the defendant's Sixth Amendment rights override the reporter's Shield law rights. So I would certainly counsel people who teach journalism or editors to instruct their reporters that they ought to make these modalities extremely clear before somebody makes the mistake of assuming that a promise by me as a reporter is bindingly valid. I'm afraid that that does exhaust our time. Thank you, Professor Van Den Hogg. Thank you, Mr. Mike Kramer of New York Magazine, Mr. William Rusher of National Review.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following: for a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.